Welcome to another episode of At the Table with Patrick Lencioni, where everything we talk about is related to changing the world of work so that more organizations can be more effective and less dysfunctional, and employees can be more fulfilled and less miserable. I'm your host, Pat Lencioni. I'm joined by my co-host, Cody Thompson. How are you doing, Cody?
Great to be back.
It's great to have you here. We have a guest on mic, Amy Hyatt, co-founder of The Table Group.
Hello, everyone. Thanks for having me.
You drew the short straw today and had to come on.
I did. I know. Thanks for this one.
No, it's because you had some really good insights to this. We've got Tracy, our trusty manager. She's really the GM of this podcast. Mm-hmm. What do we call her? What's your
producer.
Title?
Producer.
Producer. She's a producer. That's right. And we've got Matt Lencioni. He's our engineer and a lot of feedback for us as well. Good to have you guys on board. Okay, today, Cody, what are we going to talk about?
The title is Time to Go Deeper.
So it's time to go deeper. What do we mean by that? Well, this podcast and everything we do at The Table Group is related to the concept of organizational health, of course. And over the course of the past year and a half since we started the podcast, we've talked about teamwork, which is critical to organizational health, and that the foundation of teamwork is trust. And trust can only come about when team members are vulnerable with each other, comfortable being vulnerable. Now, there are different levels of vulnerability, and that's good because you don't start a relationship at the deepest level. That would be strange. That would be weird. And we've done podcast episodes about vulnerability before, like we've talked about something called the personal histories exercise, which is how we work with teams. When we work with a leadership team, that's the first exercise we do. We have people talk about where they grew up, who they are, and what was some interesting, difficult challenge of their childhood. Then we talked about the next level of vulnerability, which is using a tool to help people better understand their personality or the way they do things, like the Myers-Briggs, and there's others. And of course, our new favorite, the 6 types of working genius, which we came up with. And these tools provide a more applied and deeper understanding of a person. Today, we're going to talk about yet a deeper level of vulnerability, one that's going to sound a little uncomfortable or maybe touchy-feely at first, but it's practical and relevant as it is powerful. And it can provide a great catalyst or impetus for people making changes in their lives. And what I'm talking about are something called our wounds.
Right.
So we're going to talk about wounds today on the podcast.
Yeah. And you mentioned like this is, it can come across as touchy-feely, even as we're having the conversation, the pre-conversation about this, we're like, is this going to be okay? Like, you know, we exist in a kind of unique environment where we do have these deeper levels of vulnerability and the trust to have these conversations. But it's so critical that people understand that this impacts you. It impacts the way you show up to work. And there's so many people that are carrying around these wounds that don't have an opportunity or an environment where they can share and be vulnerable about
it. Right. And it would be easy for somebody to think that working here is so weird that we walk around the office like, what are your wounds? How are your wounds?
Wound Wednesday. That's
exactly
what we do for lunch.
And it's not that weird.
No.
It isn't. We get things done and we talk about our work. But if we want to get a lot of work done and we really care about the people we work with, we have to go deeper so that we can help them deal with things so that they can continue to improve in their lives and get more done faster.
Yeah. And I want to add, I actually don't think it's touchy-feely at all. I like just when you said that, I'm like, no, it's actually really hard and deep. Touchy-feely to me is more the light stuff you do around team building.
Good.
And that's the stuff we don't want to do. We want to go where you need to go.
Yeah, because I really do hate touchy-feely stuff.
Oh, I know.
Like I always have.
The blindfold or anything like that.
The experiential exercises where you catch each other falling out of a tree.
Right.
This is like real gritty stuff.
Yeah, and it's like the moment you don't want to talk about it is when you need to talk about it.
That's right. Yeah, Matt wanted to, what did he want to call the podcast? Like,
I don't want to go there.
I don't want to go there.
Yeah. Or time to go deeper, what'd you call it?
That's what we did
That's
call
what
it.
We did call it.
See, this is why I'm not on the beginning. This is why I'm not on the podcast that often.
No, I love it.
Well, so, I will say this, you know, one of the things that occurred to me as we were talking about this conversation is we talk about the personal histories exercise. So we sit down with a group, a team, whether that's executives or whoever we're working with, and that is scratching the surface. And we ask 3 questions, you know,
Where'd you grow up?
What order are you in terms of your brothers and sisters, the family? And then what was one of the difficult challenges that you faced when you were a child?
And I usually say not your inner childhood, but just being a kid.
Right. Mm-hmm. And this is literally like scratching the surface around vulnerability. You know, like most people, and as we're talking about this, I think what I became aware of is there are not every other thing in society, even your family members, your friends, and certainly at work, it prevents you from being vulnerable. There are built-in structures to say you shouldn't be vulnerable. So you have to actually be intentional. So the moment we sit down with that team and say, we're going to tee up this exercise, that's almost every time we've done that, they, after the exercise, they're like, I learned something new I didn't know about somebody else.
Right.
And the reality is because there aren't other opportunities in our lives. We don't sit down and we're not intentional about saying, why don't you tell me about this? And so it does feel weird when we say, we don't have Wound Wednesday, but we sit, sometimes we're like, hey, what's going on with you?
Right.
You know, like in your personal life, is that affecting your work?
You know, we should probably talk about how this came about. Mm-hmm. Because a couple people in our office, I'm one of them, went to counseling. Now mm-hmm. I'm 55. So but 2 years ago, I went to see this counselor because I heard he was really good and I wanted to deal with some stuff. And I became really aware of like, oh, wow, I have some interesting things from being a little kid that I never even realized. Mm-hmm. So we talked about it at work. Not a mm-hmm. lot, but I mean, we talked about it. And somebody else had some insights into themselves. And one day at work, I think you said, Cody, it's like, you know, I actually think this applies to me. And you were the person that we least expected. You know, right. You seem like, yeah, everything's fine.
Well, I was started asking the question, like, I wonder what my wound is. And I really, before that, I'm not sure that I had asked that question.
Right. We're like, hey, Cody, let us tell you what yours is.
Right. Amy's great at that. She gave me the little cocky nickname. So,
but the thing is, this happened because a couple people in the office actually did some therapy, mm-hmm. if you will. And I know people can roll their eyes at that, but heck, most of the people I know have been to therapy. And if it's good, it's fantastic. If it's bad, it's not. But it's a great opportunity. Well, that provoked us in the office to just sit around and talk about it. Hey, when I was a kid, did this happen to you? Suddenly our team was like figuring out, oh, that's why when we're in a meeting, you act like this. And they're like, oh, absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Or things like we've worked together for 26 years. And it's like, oh, I'm still learning something. Like you had a big revelation right before Christmas about how you think you come across.
Right.
And I was like, oh my gosh, I didn't know you thought that about yourself. If I'd known that, that would have helped in earlier conversations.
And the truth is we could have figured that out 20 years ago right. if we'd have been a little bit more intentional about this.
Right.
We could have said, let's talk about what's unique about the way you grew up and what are you carrying around with you. Now we should define wounds here though.
Yep.
Yeah.
Because people are like, what the hell are you talking about?
Right.
and we talked about this earlier. I think what a wound is, it's something that's true about us that we think is natural, but it's not actually natural and it's not helpful. Mm-hmm. It's like if you have a limp and people walk around and you go, hey, you have a limp. They're like, no, this is just how I walk. Oh, no, that's because you got injured and that's actually not the natural way to walk.
It's right. not necessarily something that's going to just heal in a few days. Right.
Exactly.
It's not an acute situation. It's more of a chronic one.
Yes. And we often incorporate it into our lives and start to think it's part of who we are at our best.
Right.
When in fact, it's not.
Right. 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 It becomes such a part of us. We don't even know that it's there.
Right.
It's the bowling ball that Cody was talking about.
Yeah. Tell us about the bowling ball thing, Cody.
Well, I mean, we've talked in the office about when you do have a wound, it's like having a broken leg or something like that because you're impeded by it. And I was having a conversation with a friend and he used the analogy of like, you're carrying around a bowling ball. And
right.
It just so happens that I like the leg analogy too, because it's hidden and it,
right.
and you sort of feel like I should be able to do this thing. But when you have to remind yourself like, no, your leg is broken or no, you're carrying that bowling ball. That's why you're not able to participate the way that you think you should. But the idea that is that we all have these things that we're carrying to our homes, to our offices, into meetings with our colleagues that are hidden, that unless we're willing to go there and put them on the table and be vulnerable about them, they will impede teamwork and progress.
And they usually come from something that happened relatively young that we just started thinking, oh, I guess this is just how things are.
Mm-hmm.
And frankly, right. we get older and we're like, so not everybody thinks this way? And it's like,
right,
no,
right.
and you yeah. shouldn't either because it's not true.
And you know, the other thing I'll mention is we always play guessing games around here. Is like, you ask the question to your therapist, how many people are carrying stuff like this around with them? And I asked that to a friend recently, and the consensus is like almost everyone.
Everybody. Yeah.
Over 90% of people have some bowling ball they're carrying around that other people don't see that's making them go slower and it's painful.
Right. Mm-hmm. It could be a bowling ball or a bocce ball or what are the pool balls? Is that what those are called?
Yeah. Pool ball. cue ball.
Cue ball.
Some are bigger than others.
Right. Exactly.
But it's really a good thing to know what they are. Now, what does this have to do with work? Because we're sitting here going,
yeah.
okay, why are we talking yeah. about this? Mm-hmm. We have figured out how to deal with one another and get things done better as a result of having these open conversations. And they're not weird. We don't roll around the floor and cry for 4 hours. We just say things like, you know, like we had a great conversation with Karen today. she said that, you know, Pat, every once in a while you get frustrated that I don't really have deep emotions. Like I don't get upset about things. And she goes, yeah, I realized that when I was a kid, there was no room for me to have any emotions. It just never got received. And at an early age as a child, I realized there's no reason for me to cry or to get upset because nobody's paying attention.
Right, right.
And now she said, I'm kind of blocked.
Right.
And that impacts the team. Like we'll be talking about something. Like, why aren't you reacting to that? She's like, I don't know. I don't know how to feel that.
But she's like the sweetest person when it's someone else's issue.
Right.
Right. Just when it's her own, it's harder.
Right. And we didn't say, okay, let's bring your parents in and a counselor to talk about this. We were like, oh.
Oh, that's interesting. And then we move on.
Well, right. And then when you put it out there though, and you just acknowledge it, like you had a great conversation. Yeah. It kind of breaks up the bowling ball.
Yeah, the bowling ball, like I'll give you a piece of it and I'll give, everyone gets to have a little piece of it. Then it's not such a weight.
Right. And I don't think there's a person we work with that hasn't been able to go, oh, wait a second. You know something? I think my issue is this. And then we talk about how does that impact the way we work? And then we can get so much more done.
Right. Right.
But I will say this because I'm always hyper aware of the people that are listening to this and going like, you guys work in an environment where you talk about this stuff all the time.
No, we don't.
There's no way that at my team with the people that I work with that we're ever going to sit down and talk about our wounds. You know, like we're never going to get there. And we talked about this, like there's definitely, do not just go out tomorrow and say, let's do Wound Wednesday at work.
Well, we had two new employees start today and you and Amy took them through orientation.
Yeah.
We didn't sit there and go, okay, it's wound time.
Yeah.
Right. No.
First day of work, they're going to run screaming.
Exactly. In fact, we didn't even do personal histories. We'll do that another time. Personal histories is like the low level exposure therapy to whatever comes next.
Right.
Like the slight vulnerabilities you need to share over time that you may or may not want to, but it gets you in the habit.
Maybe we should tell people, maybe we should give some people examples
of like
what these
look
like.
I was just going to say that. Like. Yeah. Oh, like let's, because it, then it's more applied, right?
Right. So like for mine, for instance, my mom does not listen to the podcast. So this is safe. I wouldn't, if she did, I would not do this, but, and it's not a big deal.
Right.
Well, it is a big deal, but it's not, you know, it's not negative. It's just my thing. I grew up thinking that pretty much if I did, my performance was the only way I was going to get attention.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Nobody needs to weep for me. I'm not crying here.
Right.
But I realized that my whole life I've been worried about perfection and achieving because I just really didn't feel a sense of belonging or attention or any kind of affirmation other than my performance.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Hey, it is what it is. But I thought that was normal.
Right.
And it made it really hard to enjoy most of the things I was working on because I was doing it just to survive.
Absolutely. And knowing that now, it's like, wow.
And you guys
see
can
that
say,
play out
right.
over the years. And it's also benefited us.
Right.
Like your wounds have helped us do a lot of great things. So you have to appreciate them in some way.
Yes. But what you don't want to do is keep acting
exactly,
on those.
Exactly. Exactly. You want to change them.
Now,
heal them.
I don't feel like my belonging on the team or my esteem in life is a function of the last book I wrote or what I have to do. And I can relax in that, have peace in that. And it actually makes me more effective and more
creative.
Happy.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. More creative, more happy.
And it makes me better to work with. I mean,
right.
since I've figured this out, I think everybody at work can say it's more fun to work with me.
Right. Right.
So it's not unrelated to work.
Right.
Right.
My wound is around pleasing, you know, like needing, like if only if there's anything to prove my worth, I felt like I had to always do the right thing for everyone.
Right. Service.
Right. Service. And so.
And this, you can trace it back to your childhood.
Oh yeah. And it's rewarded me. It's helped me get a lot of places. So I have to appreciate it, but also realize that I need to heal that and.
Well, if somebody were to say that, well, why do you need to change it? It's worked out for you.
Because it's miserable.
Okay. That's important. That's important to understand. These bowling balls suck.
Right. Right.
You don't want to carry around
a
bowling
whether
ball.
You wrote 8 best-selling books, if you think that's how you're going to survive and the people aren't going to love you,
right.
I'll use the L word. They're not going to love you unless you keep doing it. That sucks.
That's awful. Mm-hmm.
It's
and
awful.
The worst thing about the bowling ball is if you don't know it's there or
you're
if
right.
it's like a subtle, but now like even I was thinking of last year, Cody, you were like, hey, Amy, can you come help us with something? And I was like, hey, my wounds love to be needed. I'll be right there. You know, like you can start to make it part of the, I mean, I'm not saying to do, go do that.
No,
but
we actually have told you like we, like in the Working Genius,
right.
you have higher discernment.
Mm-hmm.
Than you do enablement.
Right.
But your enablement comes out because your wounds.
Right. Mm-hmm. I'm like, I need to please you.
And we're
in
like,
the
stop pleasing
right.
us.
Exactly.
Because actually when you please us, sometimes it doesn't help us.
Displeases. Right.
We need
exactly.
your opinion. We don't need you to just to do whatever we ask.
Yeah. And it's actually really about growth. Like the wound thing, healing the wound thing is about growth and getting yourself to the next place.
Right. You know, one of the things we were going to call this episode is like work therapy.
Because
here's the deal. we've grown more as a result of talking about this stuff mm-hmm. at work than we have in our home and even with our friends.
Mm-hmm.
Because we see each other for 9 hours a day.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And so we see that how this plays out.
Right.
We have grown more by going, Tracy, tell us about your wounds. And it's not, again, in a weird way. It's
no.
not, people wouldn't walk into our office and say, this is a freak show.
Right.
Well, and what's funny is, you know, because of the conversations that we've had, it's caused me to be more interested and try to figure out. And like, it was only a couple months ago, we were doing transition management on the board and you were going through the 7 losses. You know, you were like, here's what we experience as losses when we're going from one state to the next. And it sort of occurred to me, gave me more clarity, is that like, I wasn't really attached to any of those. And so I think some of mine mm-hmm. and that you guys experience is that more than an attachment thing, it's a disassociative thing. Like I'm pretty even keeled, even when things are pretty stressed, you mm-hmm. know, and everyone's like, what's wrong with you? Why are you, need to start freaking out.
Or,
and then the one time or two times in the last 6 years where I started freaking out, everyone was like, oh no, things are really wrong here.
You know?
Well, that, and also
Mr. and Mrs. Thompson didn't do anything bad.
No.
You know, we don't want them to think that. Everybody's got stuff.
Yeah, and I was actually thinking of you, like when you got mad at me last year for something, it actually was like refreshing.
Right.
You know, like, oh, good.
Yeah.
You Thank you.
He's in there.
Yeah. You
know? Right. I don't know why I keep coming back to this. This is probably related to my wounds in some way, but I don't want people to think this is weird.
Right. Right.
This is actually super
healthy.
It's about
growth. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, I will share something. So my son, Matt, is sitting next to me. He's 22 years old. I would do anything for Matt. But as a result of this podcast and this conversation and the stuff we're having, he just came up with something about himself that I had not realized.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And it was because we were having this conversation. Mm-hmm. And I was like, that is the biggest breakthrough I've ever had
mm-hmm.
in 22 years.
Mm-hmm.
Somehow at home, we're so close to things. Sometimes you go to the workplace and people have a new view of themselves mm-hmm. and of one another. And that causes us to become better parents, better friends, better people.
Well, and I think there's this like 20 years ago or 30 years ago, there might have been a more of a stigma against something like this. Like, oh, we don't talk about going to therapy or whatever. Now I feel like that's way less stigmatized, but still there's not these environments where it's
encouraged.
Right. And so to have a place or people around you or people that you trust to go, let's have this conversation. As a result of the topics we've talked about here, I was doing an outside fire night with some friends the other night. And what I think happens is people really crave realness.
Mm-hmm.
Realness. Like mm-hmm. I think when you get a taste of being vulnerable on a team that is more vulnerable, you want more of that.
Yeah.
And I find myself less interested in small talk about sports
Absolutely.
Or movies or whatever.
Right.
So we were around the fire and I was like, hey, this is going to sound weird. These two guys that I really enjoy that we have a good relationship with, what are your guys' wounds? And they actually told me. And one of my friends who I've been friends with for a long time, it gave me added clarity about the way he interacts with me. And so—
Isn't it nuts?
It's nuts. And the fact that we don't do it, or that there's, even though there's less stigma, we still don't make intentional places where people can talk about this. And I'll go back to the environment. Certainly don't go out tomorrow. If there's even one person on your team or in your office that is not vulnerable, that's not the right place
right.
to do this.
It's because not going to work.
It's not, what the last thing you want to do is go, time to go deeper, and somebody else pulls the reins on that.
Well, now we call it time to go deeper because there is a time to do it.
Yeah.
It's not all the time.
Well, and even just with the Matt thing, just right before this podcast, we didn't swim in it.
No. Mm-hmm.
We didn't stew in it. We just
put it out there and we said, wow, that's great to know.
Yeah.
Well, it'll come up again.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm going to go golfing with some of my friends from childhood. And I realized, hey, when I share them with my, I'm going to say, hey, I learned this thing about when I grew up, and they will have insight into it.
Oh yeah.
I know they're going to come up with their own.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And that's going to be helpful for them. Again, we'll still drink a beer and we'll still play golf and we'll still talk about other things, but there's no reason why we shouldn't talk about these things.
And it makes sense. Again, I mean, when we talk about organizational health and smart and healthy, and we talk about organizations like minimizing politics and confusion and high degrees of morale and productivity, all that side of the equation, we talk a lot about the human side of business that helps us maximize the smart side. It only makes sense that on the best teams, on the most cohesive, effective teams, that there is not a threshold or a limit necessarily. Like, you have to go deeper on vulnerability. That's the foundation of a cohesive, effective team. And it's not like, let's do the personal histories exercise one time, learn a little bit more about ourselves,
and
then we're done. And so there are levels to this. And I think it's been a real privilege to actually work with a whole team that's willing to go down that path mm-hmm. together. And it's not always been easy, and mm-hmm. we've hurt each other's mm-hmm. feelings and had to say sorry. But I think that in the context of what we're doing, the reason this isn't touchy-feely is because being on a team that now we have this level of knowledge about each other and this understanding, we get more done. I mean, these two guys that we just onboarded, this was one of their first experience with us. And I said, hey, what? He came in yesterday, he left. And today I said, what did you talk about on the ride home? You know, I want to know, like, when you left the office, what mm-hmm. did you say? And he was like, I just have never seen a group of people like function this way, you know, which was great. He didn't talk about our office or excited he was about the opportunity. He was like, I can see how you treat each other. That is really amazing. And you know, it's what allows a 10-person company to get done all the things that we get done in the world.
And, you know, and we've seen this in clients, and you can go to a big company like Southwest Airlines. You talk to the executives that have been there for a long time. They lean into one another's lives. Mm-hmm. On our, we have an assessment, you know, that we take, the team assessment that people take around the five dysfunctions of a team. And one of the questions on there is, are people comfortable talking about their personal lives? Mm-hmm. And sometimes people go, why does that matter? And you go to the best companies in the world, the kind of companies where people don't want to leave. And if you had to talk about this in a very practical way, I'd say, if you want to retain great people, let them have good, vulnerable conversations with one another about things that matter to them at work and at home. You don't Absolutely. Leave that place.
Absolutely. Well, and think about the opposite, which is when we talk about this being a wound, like a broken leg. Okay. So, or you have a bowling ball strapped to your leg and you're on a team and you go out on the field and someone tries to throw you a pass and you can't make the cut, you know, like you can't get to the ball. Your other team members are like, why didn't you get to the ball? Imagine not being able to say, I have a broken leg, mm-hmm. you know, like mm-hmm. I'm hurt, I'm injured. And too much of the world says, don't bring your personal life to work. And so all you have to do is end up stuffing it. And what it does is it reinforces your coping mechanism.
Right.
If you're in an environment where you're like, I'm injured, but I can't tell anyone I'm injured, so all I have to do is white knuckle this until I get through it. That's hurting people.
That's what we do. You know, it's funny. Imagine how you feel about that person who comes along and says, hey, there's a bowling ball here. Let me help you deal with it, or binds up your leg. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You're like, my loyalty to you and this organization is huge.
Or, hey, I've got one too. Like, it's, you can deal with it.
Right.
It's a huge difference maker. So a few episodes ago, we talked about what is your blind spot. And this relates to this as well, because your blind spot is from the Johari window. It's something that you're not aware of about yourself, but other people are.
Right.
Oftentimes our wounds are things that we are aware of, sometimes not, but other people aren't. So they don't know why we're not running faster mm-hmm. or getting mm-hmm. our work done. Mm-hmm. And there's something really liberating about saying, you guys probably should know this about me. I have really low self-esteem because of this. And so if I don't vouch for my own ideas, it's probably because I've not done that since I was a kid, because I never could. And suddenly people are like, there it is. Right. Now we understand it. So that's one of the other squares on the Johari window, not the one that you're blind spot, but something that's a secret or hidden.
The hidden mm-hmm. one.
And boy, when you go deeper with somebody, it's great to let out some of those hidden things.
Yeah. And I think the other piece it does for the individual, because this is kind of predicated on the fact that you know what your wound is, or that you're at least open to exploring that. Because the other thing is, it allows you to give yourself some grace mm-hmm. when you have a broken leg and Huge. You know you have a broken leg. Because I've found it with my colleagues and people in my life that oftentimes they're like, I should have caught that ball. And you know, or I should be able to do this. Right. And it's like,
but no, you can't.
And know this too, that just knowing that you have a broken leg doesn't heal your leg.
Right.
You know?
Mm-hmm. Diagnosis. We think that that's everything, and it's not. It's actually the treatment.
Right. Exactly.
And part of that treatment comes from talking about it mm-hmm. and helping people. There's a book that helped me understand this stuff. And it's a Christian book and a Catholic book, which I'd be a hypocrite to say that that's not a good thing for me. I love mm-hmm. that. But it's part of it is just about understanding your wounds. Now, I think I'd encourage everybody to read all of it, but it's called Be Healed. Mm-hmm. And a friend brought this to me and said, have you ever read this? And I hadn't. And it was a game changer for me. And a guy named Bob Schutz, I won't spell his name because it's really hard to spell.
S-C-H-O-U-P-S-C-H-U-C-H-T-S.
Okay.
And I actually just Googled the wounds, like, because I read the book, but I wanted to refresh my memory before this. And you can just Google it and find out more about it.
And so there's actually a list of like, mm-hmm. hey, these are the kind of, which of these wounds speaks to you? And here's the kind of lies you probably tell yourself. Right. So he goes deep. He's a psychologist, and it's a beautiful book. And I was like, oh my gosh. for me, it was not even a Johari window. It was something I was unaware of. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So
or sometimes it pops back and forth. Sometimes you're aware and then you forget. And then
absolutely.
Someone reminds you.
Exactly. So understanding your wounds, sharing those with people you work with, if it's that right time to go deeper, not people you didn't know, but you've worked with them for a little while and there's trust, can change everything. How much you get done, how much you love going to work, and whether you become a better human being. And mm-hmm. that's what organizational health is about. It's mm-hmm. not just about the bottom line, but it's about what you take home with you as well. Right. Mm-hmm. So anything else? Did we cover just about everything?
I think we did.
All righty. So I hope people have enjoyed this, and we love sharing things that can improve our lives. So until the next episode, thanks for joining us, everybody, on At the Table. God bless.